has a PhD from the London School of Economics, and for many years was a professor of sociology at Roehampton University in London. He's now professor of contemporary slavery at the Wilberforce Institute for the Study of Slavery and Emancipation at the University of Hull, which is in England. He's the author of 5 books on various aspects of the phenomena of contemporary slavery, and the co-author and editor of several more. His first book on the topic was called Disposable People. I think it's 1999. And it was the first major book-length treatment of the phenomena of modern slavery in recent times. It was nominated for the Pulitzer Prize. It's been translated into 10 languages. A documentary based on it was made, which won 2 Emmy Awards. Dr. Bales has received many awards for his work. In 2006, the Association of British Universities named his research, they put it on a list of the top 100 world-changing ideas. He is a co-founder of Free the Slaves, which is a major U.S. anti-slavery organization, and a trustee for Anti-Slavery International, which is the oldest anti-slavery or abolitionist organization. It goes back to 17th century or
1787.
So Kevin has not been a trustee for the entire time that it's been around.
I was an intern in 87.
Kevin will be speaking to us today about the content of his latest book, which is called Blood and Earth, and it's just been published by Random House. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Bales.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mike. That was great. Thank you, everyone. I was about to come up. I thought I should run up and say, you know, go. And then I didn't realize I didn't know the name of your team. What are the Tommies? Okay. Yeah, Tommy. What are you, Tommies. Okay. Anyway. Try to build a little rapport. You know, you attempt. I guess it doesn't always work. I've been having a great time here, and I'm appreciative. And I'm also appreciative that I managed to make it in last night in that blizzard. That was phenomenal. Coming from Orlando, Florida, I just left my fun time at Disney World, and then I got to the Winter Wonderland. Okay, I want to talk to you about, as Mike was saying, my new book. I'm going to start, though, with a little bit of background knowledge about the world of contemporary slavery. So let me pop a map up here. This isn't necessarily in the new book. This is just, if you're not aware of the situation of contemporary slavery around the world, this is to let you know a little bit about the size and the shape. So this is a map that we've produced for the Global Slavery Index, and this has two key things about it. First, as you notice at the bottom, that we've got 35.8 million people in slavery around the world, and that's people who are truly in slavery. We're not talking about bad jobs or bad marriages. This is real slavery, and it's also defined in a fairly narrow way, where it's a tight definition. It's not one that would include just people with bad jobs or something like that. The other part is that this map shows not the raw number of slaves in the country, but it's a map of the proportion of each country's population that's caught up in slavery. So if you look at the northwest corner or side of Africa, the very dark red there is the country of Mauritania. And we think that's the country that has the highest proportion of its population in slavery. Something like 4% of the population of that country is in slavery. Now, it's a very small country it's a very huge country in terms of area, but it's a very small country in terms of population, just a few million people. But likewise, if you see the tiny dot down there near Cuba, that's Haiti, a country that we believe, and based on random sample survey information that's been validated, something like 2% of the population of Haiti is caught up in slavery. Most of that is are child slaves in the rest of that system. But the other thing that's important about this map is that you'll notice there are no blank countries. Of the 167 countries, which are all the major countries of the world that we include in the survey, the most populous countries, there's no country without slavery. The only countries that we're finding that don't have slavery are those tiny little island countries like Vanuatu, those places has anyone ever been to Vanuatu? I didn't think so. See, I've never even met anyone from or who had traveled to Vanuatu. But except for tiny little places like that, every country in the world
seems to have flavor. And you can see sort of the density based on proportion of population according to in this map. The second thing that's just a part of the background that I think you need to know, and this actually comes from some older work, is that when we're talking about slavery, when we work as social scientists on slavery, and sometimes work as in the law as well, it's important to explain that slavery is pretty much what it's always been. So that when we define slavery, we think of it as, well, we say, in fact, it is a situation in which one person is completely controlled by another person. Violence is used to maintain that control. And the object of that control is exploitation. It might be economic, it might be sexual exploitation, but it's about total control achieved through violence or the threat of violence and aimed at exploitation. Now, that takes away any question of is it legal, is it illegal, or whatever. But it's important to remember that slavery existed before the invention of law. So slavery, we know slavery existed in human experience, in human history, before the first laws were written down. We know that it existed before the invention of money. So it's pre-monetary, pre-legal, prehistoric, in fact. We know that, too. So there's no reason to think that slavery can only be slavery if it's legal or if it involves buying and selling people, because it existed long before those things existed. There is, however, this one thing that's new about slavery. A lot of times people say, well, there's old slavery and new. It's not really like that. Slavery is pretty constant across human history. But there's this one wrinkle in modern slavery, contemporary slavery, in slavery of the last 50 to 60 years, which is new, and that's the collapse in the price of human beings in terms of acquiring them as slaves. Now, Michael told you that I, as a statistics nerd, I actually have it in my speaker's contract that I'm allowed to have one chart that looks something like this in every talk that I give. That was a joke, guys. Thank you. Okay. You know, you can tell you're back up into the Scandinavian, like, descent groups, because they're like, oh, was joke? Was that joke? Oh, yes. Yes, that was, huh. Okay. Anyway, I work a lot in Norway, so I get this about how I'll dial down to my Norwegian public speaking. Right? You know that joke about Norwegians, right? How do you tell an extrovert Norwegian? They look at your shoes when they're talking. Anyway, okay, so if we look at the price of slaves that you can draw from all kinds of records that go all the way back for 4,000 years, what you see is that for virtually all of human history, slaves were expensive. Slaves were capital purchase items. Slaves were the equivalent of buying a tractor or a big truck or something like that. And suddenly, in exact relationship to the explosion of population that occurred in the last 50 or so years, we've seen a collapse. It's simple supply and demand. You know, we all understand supply and demand, that if you flood a market with any product, if you absolutely flood it, the price of that product either falls or collapses. And that's exactly what's happened here. A perfect example of this change is if we go back just to the Deep South in 1850, because we have such amazingly precise records in the Deep South of the United States when it comes to slavery, because they were insuring slaves, they were recording the buying and selling and so forth. If you go back to then and you say, what was the average cost of an average slave? Well, an average slave in 1850 Alabama was a 19-year-old guy who could work in the field. So average, a field worker aged about 19. And in 1850, if you wanted to go out and buy a 19-year-old agricultural worker, you had to pay between $1,000 and $1,200, $1,850. But what else could you buy in 1850 for $1,000 or $1,200? You could buy a house. You could buy several hundred acres of land. Or, interestingly, as a comparison, you could buy up to 6, maybe 8 oxen. Now, I know oxen sounds funny, but remember that until we got steam power, the most powerful thing that a person could bring to any type of labor was an ox, unless you happen to live in India and be able to get an elephant. Right? But for the world that we've lived in mostly, it would be ox. So we're talking about major capital purchase items. After the 1940s and 50s, as the population went through the roof, the price of human beings has collapsed, and the $1,200 that in 1850 would equal about $45,000 in today's money has dropped to the point where in today's money, an average price for a slave around the world is around $90 to $100. Now, that's a big difference. And I will tell you that it has a range. If you wanted to acquire a person as a slave in the United States, you'd be paying $3,000, $4,000, $5,000, $6,000, in the thousands. But I can also tell you from my own experience that if you wanted to find people who cost $10, you could do so in places like northern India. And sometimes entire families can be enslaved for as little as the equivalent of $10. Okay, so that's the two things that I just wanted to make sure you understood about contemporary slavery, that it's everywhere, that it's in the 30s of millions around the world, and that we've had this collapse in the price of human beings, which alters the nature of the way people are enslaved, primarily because they stopped being capital purchase items and they began to be disposable inputs into economic processes. So slaves today are not like tractors. They're more like styrofoam cups. You buy them very cheaply, you use them as hard as you want to, and when you're done with them, you can just crumple them up and throw them away. And you actually see this around the world in the treatment of slaves. Now, I want to move on to the new information that I've got for you. I spent a lot of time in the developing world, and I've spent a lot of time visiting people in slavery around the developing world. And this is a classic situation of that. This is an enslaved family in a rock quarry. They're actually pulling out paving stones, and this is a hereditary form of slavery, and it's tough, hard work, and you'll see that there are children here. And then this is of the same quarry, but a very remarkable picture. This is actually a slaveholder of today, who one of my colleagues tricked in, because he didn't know she was an anti-slavery worker, but you know, she said, tell me about your quarry, tell me about your workers, and so forth. And he stood there and waved his hand over all of these workers. And you can see there are tiny children up in that little group of people. There's some tiny children working in the quarry there. These are entire families that are held in hereditary slavery by his family. He didn't necessarily express it all in that way so frankly, but certainly the people who were there did. Now, it was this picture in many ways that opened my eyes to the new work that I've been doing, because I was looking at this quarry, I was talking to the anti-slavery workers who had been secretly meeting with the people who lived in the village, the hereditary slaves that lived in that village. And it was actually later, when I was going back through these pictures and checking on where these things were happening and so forth, that I realized that this giant slave-based quarry is in the middle of what's supposed to be a protected national forest. But you can't see any forest except for that tiny bit of trees on the background. He has used these slaves to rip away all the topsoil, all the trees, down through all the topsoils, down to the rock. And when he's done with any parts of it, he'll just walk away. Undoubtedly, that catchment area with the water is going to be desperately polluted and so forth. And I began to think about these things and think, where else am I seeing this? And this is a picture from Ghana. This is a place which also, this is a picture also from a protected game preserve national forest in Ghana. This is a place where there are endangered species of large primates, of monkeys, and so forth. But it looks like a World War I battlefield. It was once a pretty little river through the forest. What's going on here is gold mining. The women who are on the left are in fact enslaved workers and their children, who are carrying on their heads big loads of gravel and sand, which are going up to a place where they're going to wash the gold out of it, just the way the 49ers did in California. And they've been digging and digging and digging so that they're down, again, sometimes 20, sometimes 30 feet of from the where the surface of the forest, they're down to the, they'll sometimes hit rock to the point that it's almost impossible for any of this to reclaim. You'd have to really put a lot of work in to turn it back into a forest. But you almost wouldn't want to, or it would be almost impossible to, because incredibly, the destruction that you see there is in many ways the least of the problem. Because everything you see there is saturated with mercury. Mercury is how the 49ers used to take gold out of gravel and sand. And it's the way artisanal slave-based mining is also takes gold flecks out of what they get out of the mud and the sand. And they wash it right on the edge of the river so that the mercury just runs into the river, runs into the land, and so forth. Mercury is a serious problem. Mercury is a gives you nerve damage. It gives you birth defects. It gives you brain damage. It kills your liver. If you heat it to the point that it vaporizes and you take one good inhalation of mercury vapor, it will kill you. It's dangerous stuff. And it also is dangerous because it's a mineral that doesn't degrade. You can't boil it and get rid of it. There's almost nothing you can do. So if it's saturating out there and an insect eats a seed that has mercury in it, there's mercury, that mercury just transfers to the insect. If a bird eats that insect, it transfers to the bird. If a mongoose comes along and eats the bird, it transfers, and it just goes on up, this biomagnification of mercury, so that by the time you get to a human being, you may be eating an animal and ingesting a very large dose of mercury. It's why we don't like pregnant women in the United States to eat certain fish, which we know biomagnify the amount of mercury. Well, what if, I kept thinking, what if all of this is not just an example here, an example there? What if there's actually a pattern going on? So let me start with two, I'm going to show you two, three places where I went in deep to try to understand this relationship. And the first one is in a UNESCO World Heritage Site, which is a multinational, international designation that one, when there's a UNESCO World Heritage Site, it should not be touched. You know, like Stonehenge, I think, in England is a UNESCO World Heritage Site. It's about preservation forever. And this particular one is the Sundarbans Islands, the Sundarban Forest at the bottom of Bangladesh and India. And this forest is really important in a number of ways environmentally, because the Sundarbans it's an enormous mangrove forest. And it's the largest mangrove forest possibly in the world, but certainly in Asia. And it's also the largest carbon sink in all of Asia. Now, does everyone know what a carbon sink is? No? Okay, thank you for shaking your head so well. A carbon sink is a place where there's enough trees, I'm going to do this very simply, but if there's enough trees, since trees pull CO2 out of the air, if you have to make a carbon sink, you have to have enough trees that they actually pull enough CO2 out of the air that it's pulling more CO2 out of the air than the land around it and the people around it are generating. So it's sinking that carbon. It's pulling it out of the air. And mangroves are crucially important because they're one of the best carbon pullers of all the species of trees. But that's important because, this is Asia. They're putting out a lot of CO2. That carbon sink's important. I'm going to start in all of these up high in the sky and then zoom in. So, that wasn't right. There we go. Here we are way up in the sky looking down on a bit of the Sundarbans. Everything on the right is the Sundarban forest the way it should be. A big mangrove wild forest in a riverine kind of estuary of islands. But on the left, you'll see something else is going on there. And you can see that there's a river or a bit of an estuary inlet. And those are fishing boats all along this kind of line right here. And they're bringing small fishing boats, and they're bringing fish, walking up those paths up to what look like buildings, but they're not buildings. I'll show you what they really are. They're walking up to those to process these fish into dried fish, which will be used in other ways. So when you get a little closer, what you see is these giant rectangles, which are in fact structures for drying these fish. And if you look in the back, far behind these lower ones, you'll see there are some that go up higher and higher. So the racks go high up, one up, sort of two stories, three stories of drying racks. Children are enslaved to do this work, not adults, only children, and almost all boys. So little boys like these who are slicing, cutting, messing, and then hanging them up to dry. This is another remarkable photograph because a very brave photographer, Bangladeshi photographer, went to one of these islands and got this picture of a slave driver using a big stick to whip and drive the children faster along the drying racks. And these boys work sometimes 24 hours straight, 48 hours straight, because they have to process the fish as quickly as it comes in. And if a lot of fishing boats come in after a time at sea, they just have to work to stay on top of that. If they fall asleep, they're beaten until they wake up, or if they go a little slow, or if they get a little clumsy or addled because they're so sleep deprived and they stumble and they make mistakes, they get beaten. It's all part of that process of getting those fish sorted out. They sit like this all night, slicing, cutting. They're working with knives. They cut themselves. I spoke with four of these young guys in depth about their work. I spoke with them the morning after they had escaped from slavery. They had managed to hide themselves on a fishing boat late the night before. One of the boys had realized that he knew someone on this fishing boat, convinced him to hide him, and they brought them up river. And I was in a small village that you could only access by boat from the river. And I happened to be able to meet them off that boat when they came in from the slave-based camp. And they told me about what this was like. And I interviewed each of them separately in great detail. But they, you know, I was asking them about what it was like, how things happened. And not surprisingly, they told me about we were beaten. They were saying the younger boys were often sexually assaulted. I asked them about their well-being and health, and every boy said to me that the biggest health problem they had was diarrhea. Now, they didn't have a better name for it, they just said diarrhea. But they said almost all the kids at almost all the time had diarrhea, which doesn't surprise me. They had no toilets, they had no sewage, they were sitting in rotting fish guts the whole time. It was a terrible problem. But I also asked them, biggest health problem they had? And every child said to me the same thing, and it was something that kind of blew my mind, because they said, every boy said that they had either witnessed or they had known another boy who had been eaten by a tiger. Now, I was very surprised by this, but after thinking about it a little while, I began to realize It was an inevitability, and it also encapsulated a whole lot of what this book is about. The idea that if you have people who are criminal slaveholders who are happy to destroy the environment, and if that environment is in fact a UNESCO World Heritage Site, in part because it's the last large breeding ground of the endangered Bengal tigers, then if you tear that forest up and you make it impossible for the tigers to have their natural lives, and you drive out their prey species, which are small deer like this, we shouldn't be surprised that they'll turn to the next small animal that is sent into that forest, which in this case will be slave children. It illustrates pretty perfectly how the destruction of one can lead to the destruction of the other. The destruction of the environment can lead to the destruction of human life as well. Now, it's fair to say, you're telling us, Kevin, about how these two things fit together, but what drives all this? Well, what drives this particular type of environmental destruction and enslavement of children is things like the shrimp that we eat and the food that our cat eats. Who has a cat? Yeah, I think you're going to have a chat with your cat. Right? You can tell that after I did a taste test with this cat and then told them about where it came from and how guilty that cat looks. Okay, I didn't really. But it took me a long time to find a guilty-looking cat, I have to say, to put in the slide. That's where a lot of that dried fish goes. It gets dried, pulped, powdered, might end up as fish stock for stock cubes for soup, or it might end up in cat food and so forth. The shrimp that we tend to buy in North America, almost all of it comes from South Asia. It comes on enormous tanker ships and freezers, and it ends up in our shops in those big bags of fairly cheap shrimp that come along to us. that's what draw. That's the fuel that drives this circle of slavery and environmental destruction in Bangladesh. Let's go somewhere else though. Let's go up much further up near the Himalaya Mountains. Up in the just below the Himalayas, all across Pakistan, India, Nepal, and Indochina, there's a belt. This is called the Brick Belt, and it has to do with geological formations. It has to do with clay, and it has to do with the ease of taking clay and making bricks. And here's a brick kiln taken from the sky. It's a little hard to see how that works, but here's a diagram of it and I put in a person so you can see the scale of it. And what happens is that, you know, enslaved workers, usually families, form the bricks by hand. If you've read Exodus, where, you know, the Jews in Egypt are made to make bricks, and they talk about how they make the bricks and, you know, what the Pharaoh expects of them, it's the same process. This is biblical style brick making, right, that goes on. It's at the very bottom of the kind of technologies of how you would do something like make bricks. And then, a little better than what they had in ancient Egypt, they then have a way of stacking them, and then they stack them so that it moves around that circle like the track around a football field, and they stack in front of the fire raw bricks to be fired, and then after the fire passes, they take away the fired bricks, and then they get ready to keep stacking in front, and the fire goes around and around the oval. The problem with this is not so much about the destruction of the land around brick kilns. It's just another way that slavery has this enormously detrimental impact on the environment. Because it's true, while the clay is being taken, it's not being taken in a way that necessarily wipes out whole species. It's all about the fuel, what the fuel is as these families are, and they're really caught up in it, are enslaved to make the bricks. The primary fuel for these illegal brick-making industry is used motor oil and old automobile tires. Now, that may or may not sound horrific, but you need to know that used motor oil, one of the reasons why there are laws about where you can dispose of it, is that it's full of heavy metals, special metals, and chemicals that if you burn it in particular, it releases highly carcinogenic, highly poisonous gases, fumes, and residue. And I don't know if you know, very few of us have been involved in burning car tires, but in the United States, if a fire breaks out in a place where they store car tires, that is a class one environmental disaster as ranked by the federal government and the EPA, and it requires an emergency disaster response because the same types of carcinogens are released, and they don't just go into the air, but they also, as the tire burns, flow into the ground and so forth. So we're talking about a completely uncontained, enormously powerfully destructive, both for humans and animals and for plant life, kind of air pollution. And there are thousands and thousands and thousands of these kilns. And to the best of my calculation, they put out also about 2.5 to 3 million tons of CO2 every year, which on one level isn't a huge amount. Where does all that go? It goes into the building boom of South Asia. All over South Asia, India in particular, skyscrapers are going up, buildings are going up. The new middle class is enjoying a new middle class life in India and Pakistan. And a lot of that is fueled by this local production of bricks. Now, I want to go just one more place, and then we'll stop talking about the really depressing stuff. We'll go on to some happier things. But I want to go into the Amazon. And remember, the Amazon isn't just Brazil. It includes Peru and Ecuador and Colombia. Here's a picture taken by an astronaut from, I think it was from Space Lab or something like that. But this is, the river you see there is the Xingu River. And that's where I spent a lot of the time doing research for this book, was up north of the Xingu. The Xingu in the past has often been seen as the boundary of the true, uncorrupted, pure Amazon forest. And a lot of the land around, and especially north of the Xingu, was set aside in the 1950s as enormous tracts of it were set aside as the property of indigenous tribal peoples. So it's areas where it should never be touched. Only the tribal peoples are supposed to have control over it. But as you can see from this picture taken from outer space, huge fires are burning across the Amazon forest around the Xingu. And that's because criminals, often again using enslaved workers, are burning out land in order to take some wood away and otherwise just to clear it and sell it off fraudulently to people who think they want to put cattle on it because they're under the mistaken impression that they can make a profit out of cattle, which they can't in that particular area. Now, this is a slightly tricky map to look at, but bear with me for a moment, because when I help you bring it into focus, you'll find that it's got a lot of, there's a lot of meat on this particular bone. This isn't a map of Brazil. This isn't even a map of the whole Amazon. This is just a map of the southern half of the Amazonian basin. And that big purple line across the top is the Amazon. That's the Amazon River. Now, what you see in this map is that the green parts of this map are the parts of the Amazon which are supposed to never be cut or messed with, the reserves of the Amazonian forest, which are still forest. So the green parts are the parts that are still intact rainforest, the lungs of the planet that we all want to hold on to. The yellow parts of the map are the parts of that protected forest which have now been cut. So you can see the loss of significant parts of the Amazon that we're all hoping to protect. And the purple parts off to the side are parts that weren't necessarily protected, so we're not going to worry about those for a moment. What are the dots about, though? The dots are the key to this in many ways. So the blue dots are cases of slavery. And the bigger the blue dots, the more slaves in that situation. The red dots are murders. And I need to be very clear, these are just the cases of slavery that the authorities were able to learn about. Most slavery cases in the Amazon are never known to the authorities. And we know that a lot of the murders that occur in the Amazon are not known to the authorities. Only sometimes high-profile murders, and I'll talk about one of those in a moment. Now, what you can see then, when you look at the yellows and at the dots, is in a way, if you can visualize, this is the blade of the scythe that is cutting away the forest that we all hope is going to remain there to be the lungs of our planet, the biggest, greatest nature reserve of biodiversity on the planet. And you can see what happens, you know, how does that come to be cut? How do we come to lose that great forest and release all that CO2? It's through the process of slavery and murder. And you can see that very clearly, you know, I wish I had a super pointer here, but sort of just straight above me right here, you'll see that one big blue dot with a circle of red dots around it. That blue, the size of that blue dot means that there were more than 50 slaves in that particular slavery case. And that circle of red dots, each one of those is a murder that they know about. So we're talking about a big block of slavery surrounded by murders. And then if the lights were a little dimmer, you would see that, you know, those murders and slavery is the center of a large yellow patch on that map, which says those murders and that slavery were used as part of the tools to destroy that circular part of the Amazon. This was done by a group called Reporter Brazil, who are amazing investigative reporters in Brazil. If we go up a little, jump up in the air again a little bit, some of this is cut to sell off, some of it to steal the timber, some of it's to drive indigenous peoples out so they can do other things with it. Part of it is actually being done to cut the forests and then burn them, but in a controlled way to produce charcoal. And what you see here is on the right side a clear-cut forest, and on the left side, the forest still standing, but the two bumpy lines in the middle are in fact low charcoal ovens set up to feed the timber in that's been cut, to burn them under controlled circumstances so that they make not just ash, but charcoal. Now, if we go a little closer, you can see in the background those bumps. You can see what those are what the little charcoal ovens look like. And that's an enslaved worker who is carrying a big load of charcoal in a can to dump in the back of a truck. Because this isn't for barbecue, right? This is not charcoal for barbecue. This is charcoal that feeds into the Brazilian iron and steel industry. Brazil has iron ore. Wait, Minnesota has iron ore, doesn't it? But Minnesota also, if it doesn't have it always right here, can actually acquire from other parts of the United States coal and coke, the things you need to smelt iron ore into iron, to smelt iron into steel at different grades. Brazil has iron ore, but it doesn't have coal and coke in sufficient amounts. So even though it seems kind of crazy to me, in the past, they developed the pattern of simply destroying their forests, burning them into charcoal, and then using that charcoal as the way of converting iron ore into iron ingots and into low-grade steel. And where does that go? Well, part of it goes into the murders that lead to these kinds of excavations that I was witnessing in Congo, of shallow graves all through the forests, or where the forests used to be, of workers who had been enslaved and then disposed of, disposable workers. These were, I guess you could call these guys CSI Amazonia or something like that, but they were discovering these graves all around. And of course, you guys probably know that, you know, some of these victims of murder, some of the more high profile ones that weren't just dumped in forests, have been as well people like Sister Dorothy Stang, the American nun who for many years worked in exactly this area around the Xingu, doing environmental protection and anti-slavery work until she was assassinated. And it was clearly, you know, if you can read about her murder, but it was clearly an assassination. You know, when two people lie in wait and open up with two sets of weapons, and then, you know, shoot her several times until she's lying on her stomach, and then they come up and behind her and shoot in the back of the head as well. It's, you know, this is not about I got angry at someone and shot them. This is clearly an assassination. And while I was there, a couple in their late 50s who had also been doing demonstration work to how you could live in the forest without cutting it down and making it sustainable were also assassinated. And again, it was very clearly assassination by timber interests who wanted to cut all of their land and take them away. And in their case, it was pretty obvious that it was assassination because an ear was taken from each of their heads to be a marker that the assassination had occurred. Where does it go? It goes into car parts, it goes into plumbing fixtures. This is one of the key ways that Brazilian steel and iron enters North America and Western Europe. So things all around us, right? Things that touch all around us. And in fact, I'm just looking at the seats that you're sitting in. Sheet steel that goes into car bodies is basically the same stuff that's underneath the cushion you're sitting on these chairs. So that could be Brazilian steel as well. Sorry. Did you make the wiggle your thing? Now, I want to pull way back now for a moment and talk a little bit about the size of this. It's one thing to say, okay, all of this goes on in Brazil, all of this goes on in Bangladesh, right? But it's another thing to say, but climate change is a global problem. Slavery is a global problem. How do we conceptualize it and understand it at that level? Well, one of the ways is by aggregating up and making clear how this fits together. And one of the things that helps to illustrate that is this little thought exercise here. See, if slavery were a country, or if slavery were an American state, that 35.8 million people in slavery, that would give you basically the population of Canada, or it would give you the population of the state of California. So it wouldn't be a big country at all. It would be a smallish country. And it would also be a poor country, because we know from the ILO and other UN estimates that slavery puts into the global economy about $150 billion a year, which sounds like a lot of money, but in fact, in global terms, $150 billion is peanuts. It's the GDP, the gross domestic product of Angola. Or it surprised me when I found out that the GDP of Kansas, right, the economic volume of activity in Kansas is about $150 billion a year. I somehow thought it would be less than that, but okay. So if slavery were a country, it would be a small, poor country that you wouldn't expect to have very much industrial activity at all. But if you then say, well, how much CO2 is coming out of slavery. If we look across all the deforestation in particular that's occurring that's illegal, and we understand and we make very conservative estimates about what proportion of illegal deforestation is occurring with slave labor, always leaning on the lower side of every estimate, and you add all that together using the United Nations red figures of deforestation, it turns out that if slavery were a country, it would be the third largest emitter of carbon dioxide in the world after China and the United States as a country. And if we were talking about per capita emissions, in other words, how much per CO2 emission per person in that country, then slavery would be by far the largest emitter of CO2 per capita on the planet. I mean, there may be a lot more carbon coming out of China, but there are more than a billion Chinese. In the United States, we only have 300 million some citizens of the United States. And Americans, sorry guys, but Americans are per capita the biggest emitters, individual emitters of CO2 on the planet by a long shot. Or they were until now. Because if these figures are correct and they've been checked over by lots of other people, then every slave in the world is emitting something like 7 or 8 times as much CO2 as you do, even when you're driving your daddy's Escalade, right? That's a huge shift in how we understand how this fits together. But here's the good news. That's not bad news. That's actually opening a possibility to positive change. Because 35 million people are a lot easier to reach than 300 million, and certainly easier to reach than a billion people. See, it's all about the trees in so many ways. Slave-based deforestation has been rampant over the last 20 to 30 years in ways that we didn't quite understand, and in ways which had in fact been driven by good ideas. Environmental treaties, regulations, and particularly set-aside programs had set aside, particularly in the developing world, huge amounts of pure forest that were supposed to be safeguarded, as with UNESCO World Heritage Sites. But sadly, when those areas were set aside and legal cutting of timbering and deforestation was pretty much brought to an end, criminals stepped into that vacuum and began to use slave labor to accomplish what had been done legally in the past. And what we had failed to do, and I mean we globally had failed to do, was that when we, you know, supported the government of, say, the Gambia to set aside this 1,000 square miles of beautiful forest, was that we failed with the follow-through. We didn't provide the infrastructure for protection of that forest. So all around the world, what you find are giant forests, primeval forests, virgin forests, being attacked by armed groups of thugs who have weapons and personnel and vehicles, and there'll be, you know, two forest rangers who share one bicycle, who are supposed to stand up to them. In the Congo, where I did a lot of the work for this book, that was exactly the case. The Virunga National Park, which is one of the most amazing places in the world where the gorillas live, the last of the really big gorillas live, which had been under protection since the 1920s, there's only a handful of rangers. And their murder rate on those rangers is right through the ceiling. I mean, it's amazing that they can ever hire people to take that job, because they're up against whole brigades of rebels who have stopped being political fighters and have become fighters who want to control timber and minerals and so forth. The other thing is that places like the bottom of Bangladesh and the Sundarbans, one of the things that's kind of wonderful is that those little mangrove trees, those scruffy little mangrove trees, actually process CO2 out of the air 4 times faster than big deciduous forest trees. And it's because they have this special skill that they can take carbon out of the air, and then they don't just store it in the wood the way big deciduous trees do. They release it as calcium carbonates or bicarbonates into carbonate crystals into the water that flows around their root systems. So it fixes it into the ocean, not forever, but for a long time. Right? It fixes it into a long time. So every time even those scruffy little mangrove trees get sliced away to create a shrimp farm or a fish processing camp, bad things begin to happen about carbon that's not pulled out of the air and protection and species that are not protected. I'm sorry, I hate it when I have to put more than three words on a slide, but this, I think, just had to be kind of set out like this. Here's our situation. We have, at the present moment, 48% more CO2 being emitted from all of our different activities around the world into the atmosphere than forests could, in a sense, pull back down. You know, if we go back 50, 60, 100 years, there was enough forest cover on the planet to pretty much balance out all of this human emission. It was when we began to overstep that that we begin to have the real problems with things like CO2 levels rising. So 48% more CO2 goes into the air than forests can remove. Now, if we don't do anything and think about how this stuff works, and when I say anything, it doesn't have to be just about slavery and deforestation. It could be about, we could all stop driving, we could all stop eating meat. Those two things alone would reduce CO2 emissions enormously. I don't quite see that happening, and certainly in Minnesota. But if we don't, you know, if we do nothing about slavery and deforestation, we just see that cycle spinning around where as more deforestation removes the ability to take carbon out of the air, then more goes into the air and less can be taken away and so forth, and you get a rapid rise. But if we were able to do something that's not radical at all, I mean, really, not radical at all. If we simply enforce the law that's on the books in every single country in the world that says there will be no slavery in this country, if we were able to enforce that law and say, stop that slavery, arrest those slaveholders, and then we were able to especially take the next step and say to the people who had just been freed from slavery, how would you like a job replanting the forests? If you actually used freed slaves to step in and do reforestation, you would be able to expand the forest, absorb more CO2. And I use the word redemption. That's a pretty loaded word, but I thought it was a little better than energy balance recurrence, right? Which is the more ecological, you know, geographical, to talk about the energy balance, that point at which we begin to get back toward that situation where we're taking as much CO2 out of the air as we're pumping into the air. What's the magic number for CO2? 350. 350 parts per million is sort of the balance point, where if we can keep it at 350, we don't get high temperature variations, we stabilize the atmosphere, all this whole climate change concept begins to calm down. But where are we now? 440, 430, something like that. Point is, too high and climbing. Reforestation and a lot of other things, but slavery and reforestation could begin to slow that growth and possibly even stall it. Now, a couple of things to say about that. Why do I think these incredibly utopian ideas are possible? Well, because over the last 20 years, we've learned how to get people out of slavery. There are a lot of anti-slavery organizations now who have built intervention processes and systems and mechanisms that really do the job of getting people out of slavery in an efficient way and helping them to stay out of slavery forever. And we also know how to get CO2 down. You know, we know how, you know, Al Gore made a whole movie about how do we make that change, and change our light bulbs, and drive smaller cars, and hybrids, and a whole bunch of things we can do. But there's some of these things that really would be win-win. For example, if you, again, calculate up and say, well, how much of the world has been deforested in any legal way? Forests that we've already set aside legally to say we're protecting these forests forever. How much of those have been cut? And how much would it, you know, could we make if we reforested them? Well, leaving aside the fact that the carbon situation would be improved, when you reforest, if you plant forests or you put forests back, one of the things you can do when you do that is to sell carbon credits on the global market. Now, carbon credits are controversial for a whole lot of pretty good reasons. But when the carbon credit is coming from putting back a forest that's already been there before, it's not quite as controversial as some of the others. And at the current rate of carbon credit costs per 1,000 pounds of of carbon. And if we were able to reforest, you paying the freed slaves to do so, they would generate something like, well, I say 68.5. The price of carbon credits has collapsed with the price of oil. It would only be about $55 billion now. $55 billion is more than you need to, in fact, get almost everyone in the world out of slavery. $55 billion is enough to certainly pay for all that reforestation. I think that would probably glut the carbon credit market if you actually could generate all that, and it might collapse as well. But the point is, you know, not only is there a good thing to do, but it looks like there's a way where it pays for itself. Last couple of things to show you. This is José. He was once a landless peasant in Brazil. He was once enslaved to cut down forests in Brazil. He was also pushed and enslaved in a mine in Brazil. You can see that he's looking pretty happy and pretty cocky in that picture. And the reason why is not just because he's got great boots, new clothes. He's holding the keys of a vehicle. You notice he's kind of showing that off in his hand. He's got a great hat. It's because he began to work with the Pastoral Land Commission, the Roman Catholic wing for social justice within Brazil, in a cooperative that they set up on the Xingu River, And they began to work with landless peasants who had also often been enslaved, like José. And they said, look, here's this government program. Under this program, you can be awarded control, but not ownership, but control of 200 acres of Amazonian forest. And here's the thing, though. You can only have control of this 200 acres if you don't cut, you can only cut up to 5 acres. The other 195 acres you have to preserve as Amazonian forest. Now, the idea is that 5 acres gives you a place to put your house, maybe have a few animals, and put in your vegetable gardens. But it says you can do whatever else you can do with the forest, you just have to let the main trees grow. The bags behind him are full of cocoa beans. Where did the cocoa tree originate? Where's the natural habitat of the cocoa tree? It's the Amazon. And if you take cocoa trees, and if you have a bit of Amazonian forest, and you plant cocoa trees under the giant trees, the giant Amazonian Brazil nut trees, spread them around in a way that doesn't make monoculture so that they don't get fungus and they don't share the diseases that cocoa trees do get, you are able to get this amazing, usually organic, fair trade cocoa in high volumes. The reason why he looks so happy is that after spending his life as a landless peasant with no home, no house, no food, diseases, the whole thing, his kids never going to school, within 3 years, when the trees got big enough to yield, they bought a motorbike, a refrigerator. All the kids got all the books that they needed to go to school. They were able to have medical care. And he told me something that was kind of mind-blowing for him, was that he said, you know, he was telling me how happy he was all about this. And then he said, and you know, last month, my wife and I went to the coast, to the beach, to the ocean, just to go. A holiday. A completely incomprehensible concept to most people in the world who live at that $1, $2 a day level. But he had done that, and he was so proud. So, you know, you can see he was kind of cocky with it. He left, and the guys in the cooperative said, and you know, he's not even one of our good farmers, which I thought was really interesting, because he was very excited about it and doing brilliantly. They said, yeah, he's a little lazy. He, you know, some of the other farmers do a lot better than he does. Now, this little bit of film, this little boy leading out a procession to plant trees. Do you remember the people you saw at the very beginning of my talk, the people who were enslaved in the rock quarry? These are the same families. These are the same families after they had gone through a process of liberation. It was a community organizing model that was done by a local NGO that gets people out of slavery. They helped them to work together to fight for their own freedom. They came to freedom, and then the first thing they did when they came to freedom was they said, what all groups that I've ever met and that come out of slavery as communities, they said, we want to build a school, because they always believe and truly believe that if their children can go to school, they will become unenslavable. They won't be ignorant the way they were. But the second thing they said was once we got a school built in there, was they said, we want to replant this forest. Because we know from the stories of our grandparents that this was once a great forest. And we know that when we lived here within a forest, there were trees that would give us fruit. There were trees that would give us fuel. There were trees that would give us fiber to weave into cloth. There were trees that would give us wood to make furniture with. There were trees that would give us fodder to feed to our animals. And we want to replant those trees and make this anew again. And the reason why I stopped right there on the film and froze it was because you see this guy in the background, but the guy in the slightly Western clothes, that's the forest ranger that was bribed to turn a blind eye by the slaveholder as his forest was being destroyed. And I thought it was very forgiving of those previously enslaved villagers that they didn't just beat this guy up and throw him out the way they kind of like to do sometimes. But they said, look, we understand that you were under the control of the same big boss man criminal that we were. We were just in a worse situation than you. But they also said to him, but make no mistake, you're working for the community now. You're not working for the slaveholder. And we've got our eyes on you, and you're going to protect our forest. It's your forest too, but you're going to protect our forest. And that's precisely what they're doing. That story can be replicated. We know that can be replicated too, just like José in Brazil. That's the big story of how these things fit together. This is the book. If things had worked out the way they were supposed to, there would be a whole stack of the books in the back, and you could have had signed books and all that kind of thing. But there was a blizzard on the East Coast that shut down the warehouse, and then after that blizzard melted, there was a blizzard in the middle, and so who knows where those books are? I think they're probably being burned to warm UPS drivers somewhere, something like that. But if you have interest in this book, obviously I would just say go off to Amazon, because then you can even get it as a Kindle book or whatever. So I'd be very happy to take some questions. Sure. Yes. Forest Ranger.
Distinction between people that are paid to do something and people that are enslaved. It's interesting that the slaves themselves view the lowest order of that as under the same compulsion, in a way, as they were. And so to me, I feel completely powerless and depressed and full of malaise because I just don't think, I mean, because, you know, I could stop buying shrimp and that might make me feel better. But really, it's not going to do anything to the structural situation that's producing the thing. So I just was wondering your views on, I mean, I don't know. I mean, is that too pessimistic?
Well, I don't know. Eeyore, you can't be made happy, but and that's possible too, but I can try. Right? For starts, I understand what you're saying about global capitalism and the structure of it all. But you know what's happening in northern India? That's not global capitalism. That's feudalism. I mean, it really is feudalism. And I appreciate it's interlocking with that kind of capitalism. But It's not something that's being driven, that particular type up there with that quarrying, that's not being driven along by global markets in the same way that you might think. It's mostly local stuff, and a lot of it's local agriculture as well. So I get it, but I don't think it's that. And the other reason why I don't think you can put quite the finger on it is that while I've made a point of talking about what we buy feeding into that system, there's a good news about how much it feeds into the system. Because remember I said 150 billion in slave output globally, worldwide, out of that 36 million slaves. Well, for starters, 36 million out of a 7.2 billion population in terms of the workforce is this tiny, tiny fraction of the global workforce. And that 150 billion is an even tinier fraction of the 12 trillion in the global economy. What I'm getting at is that we have some serious problems with global inequalities and the capitalist approach. I'm a true believer that we have a problem with the capitalist approach. But slavery is such a tiny fraction of that, that while it's indicative of the processes, if we were able to somehow just snap our fingers and end slavery tomorrow, you wouldn't see the price of anything change. You wouldn't see really any impact on the global economy whatsoever. That doesn't solve the the structural problem of capitalism. But it does say you can address slavery within that, and the global capitalism will not suddenly turn around and slap you down because you're somehow messing with it. Does that help?
What each qualitative distinction between slavery, what if what we call slavery is just the end?
Yeah, I get you.
Gradual extension of contracts, right? Where, you know, a garment.
I'm with you, and you could say I'm cowardly, right? I'm only going to take on a 36 million person problem, right? I know you're not saying. I'm kidding about myself, right? But as opposed to the 2 billion person problem, which is in fact the entire workforce of the planet who are in pretty low wages and under sometimes onerous and sometimes highly exploitative work. My personal feeling about that is I want to see that change too. And my personal approach to changing that is to take it at the very, very bottom and push up. And to say, if we can take away the 36 million at the bottom who are in slavery, it's going to make it easier to say, to push up above that and just make alterations about how people fit with that. There's a lot of variables that go into that. Population change is one of those and so forth. But I don't feel the same despair that you do. And maybe it's because I have this really happy situation that in my line of work, I get to see people come out of slavery and achieve freedom. And I got to tell you, job satisfaction when that happens is phenomenal. Right? Like at the end of the day, it's really great like when you're teaching and like somebody like wakes up and has great ideas and writes a great piece of work, you'd be like, okay. But I got to tell you, at the end of the week when somebody says, here's the email with the picture of the 12 people who just came out of slavery and here's them in their new lives. Well, you know, the freedom of any individual person is proves that the freedom of any other person is possible. There's also that way of thinking about it. That when one person comes to freedom, they go through a process which just demonstrates once more that any person in slavery could come to freedom if we create the right context for it. It won't necessarily alter the economic systems, but of course, slavery existed before capitalism, right? And it will probably exist, I hope not, but it could, after it, or whatever that means. Yes.
That was really loud. I'm sorry about that.
Right.
I was wondering how do they acquire these slaves? Is there like a pre-established market where they buy them from certain sellers, or do they take them from villages, from kidnapping, abduction?
That's a great question. And there's a lot of different ways that people come into slavery. And in fact, you can think of them as sort of conduits or mechanisms by which people come into slavery. So some of the ones that you were just looking at were hereditary slaves. So quite a few generations ago with those families, maybe four and five generations, we're not even sure because they can only remember back three or four generations. But somebody said to those families, I can help you. I can give you a place to work here and we'll provide food to you but you'll have to do other work for us. And it very quickly evolved into a hereditary form of slavery, legitimated by what was usually a completely fictitious concept of debt. That's why it's called hereditary collateral slavery, because what they assure the people and convince them of is that, in fact, you know, because your child is dying, you come to me and ask for $10 to buy medicine to save them, and I say, you don't have anything to give me for collateral. You're poor. You're never going to pay me back. So she says, but my child is dying. And they say, well, I guess there's one way we could do this. I'm going to give you the $10 for the medicine. But for collateral, since you don't own anything, I'm going to ask this. I'm going to ask all the work that you do and all the work that your family does will, and all of the output of that work will belong to me as collateral until you repay the debt. Don't you see how clever that is? Right? If I can get you to give me, if I own you as collateral until you repay me, how can you repay me? Because everything you produce already belongs to me as payment of collateral. Collateral hereditary debt bondage is what it's called. But boy, does it work, generation after generation. But then some people are often just like these chaps. They're just told, hey, how would you like to work in a gold mine? You know, we know you're in really bad shape. You have no jobs. You can't get work. How would you like to come work in a gold mine? They're like, yeah, that sounds great. But then they get there, and they play the same debt game on them. But the other thing about these guys is they don't have to worry about them trying to really hardly even running away, because these guys turn over so rapidly, and they turn over so rapidly because they die. They're usually dead within 2 years of silicosis, acute chronic silicosis. It comes from a quartzite dust that they have to breathe constantly. People in the United States get silicosis sometimes on their jobs in mining, but it takes like 20 or 30 years to kill you. But they're breathing so much of it and without any safety equipment that you know, they don't have to worry about it. They'll get one solid year of work out of them by convincing them that, ooh, you can get a gold nugget sometime and get out of here, right? Which they never get the gold nugget. And then by then they're sick and they're coughing and another year they're dead. So there's all kinds of ways. I think the other final thing to answer to your question, because it could go on for a long time telling you about all the different ways that people come into slavery, is that a lot of people come into slavery for doing exactly what you or I would do if we were in their shoes. If we were refugees, if we were fleeing a dangerous country or a dangerous place, if we were fleeing a place of environmental destruction, like our village had been wiped out by a tidal wave or something, and we thought there was a possibility of work that where we could find a safe place for our children, we'd say, sure, of course we'll do that. It's just that so often that's a trap. It's set, right? What's another question? Wait, I want students. All these grown-ups. No, no, no. Student.
I've got two questions, if that's fine.
Sure.
First is that, realistically, so I know you talked about a couple solutions, but that's kind of on the huge scale of things. On an individual level, like for people like us here, sitting here, mm-hmm. introduced to new information like this, we go back to our dorms, we go back to our lives. What should we do? Is there anything that on the individual level you can do to help lead to something that can, you know, cause a solution?
Or of course, and of course there is. And shall I answer that one first?
Yeah, sure.
So what can you do? What can students do? Okay, well, you know, let me say what I want. I know what students usually want to do. Right? What students usually want to do is they want to do a summer internship with an anti-slavery group, and they want to go over to India, and they want to like go find out where their slave children are locked in this room, and then they want to sneak up right about sundown and then kick the door in and grab the slave child and take them up like this, and then just as the sun is setting and putting this golden glow on them, the little slave child says, thank you for saving me from this, and this little tear runs out, you know, and then that's the best internship you could ever have, right? But it won't work like that, okay? You guys are more realistic. But I know that you know that you often have these ideas when you're young, like, oh, we could do this amazingly dramatic thing. But you know what? Changing human rights situations takes a whole lot of really boring actions as well, not just the dramatic ones. Those don't happen very often. You know, a student can think about what they're eating and buying and talking about it. I mean, we're at this very beginning of this anti-slavery movement. This is the fourth great anti-slavery movement in human history, and we're right at the beginning of it. So you're like the Harriet Tubmans. You're like the Frederick Douglasses. You're like the people who are just starting this out, the first people who say, it's not going to do anything if I don't eat sugar, but damn it, I'm not going to eat sugar from slaves, right? As they did in 1820, as they did in 1790. Right? Somebody had to start saying that. Even the shrimp. They had to say, I'm not going to eat this shrimp. And I'm going to tell people I'm not eating shrimp, right? If that's what it's going to do. And then the other part of it, though, is that you don't feel rich. You're students. You don't feel rich. But of course, you also know, because you're thoughtful and caring students, that you are rich. Compared to almost everyone in the world, you're rich. And I can tell you that the people who get people out of slavery around the world, the people who actually put their lives on the line, risk their lives to pull people out of slavery, those people get paid like $200 a month, $300 a month. They work at that level. So even a student who's poor by our standards is rich by their standards. And even a student who can say, okay, $5 a month, I could send that to an anti-slavery organization that works on the ground in the developing world. And that would just pick up that little bit of that salary and medical care that they often need or whatever to support that person who's getting people out of slavery. You know, just those two things, right? A moral action on this end, a support for someone who's taking the risk that you would take on the other. That's just two little things. And the other thing is, of course, you can always just educate yourself more so that you become more expert, and then you can say, I have skills, I have talents, I have special ways of doing things. How could I apply those to this problem? Because I'm just a guy that does it my way. But your way could be better by playing the clarinet or something, for all I know. What's your second question?
I was just curious as to what made you want to start researching this whole topic?
I picked up this leaflet once a long time ago in London back in the early 90s, and this leaflet said there are millions of slaves in the world today, and I just thought, that's nonsense. There can't be slaves. I just thought, there's no more. You know, we know there's no. But then it kind of got to bugging me. As a sociologist, as an anthropologist, I was just like, what if there were? And I began to dig and dig and dig. And what was originally just an academic scholarly investigation, I reached a point where I realized I have to go into the field if I'm really going to get a grip on this. And that led to that book called Disposable People. But out there in the field, I met and started and was hanging around people in slavery. And I got to tell you, when you get up close to people in slavery, and you see the suffering and the hopelessness and the brutality, it does something to you. And that's what led me to say, hey, I want to approach this as a scholar, but I also then said, I need to help start an organization that will get people out of slavery, because I couldn't just study people like, you know, butterflies or something and then walk away. I needed to do that as well. But I still wanted to maintain the scholarship, because we don't understand this terribly well. There are huge areas in the study of what goes on in contemporary slavery and human trafficking which we know nothing about, or virtually nothing. We don't know enough about psychological rehabilitation to fill a cup. I mean, we just don't know. And all of those areas need work, and all of those are going to need smart students like you, because I'm so old, I've only got like 5 years before I'm due lally, right? You guys are going to have to take over. What's another question? Student. Okay, go ahead.
This is just kind of, he was kind of individual question. I'm kind of asking on like a bigger picture, I guess, about the carbon credits.
Mm-hmm.
Like if we used that as a method, and then like everything was regenerated, and then you said that like those would be able to be reduced, then wouldn't eventually we be back where we were? You know, because like if you like stop penalizing people for like their carbon footprint, then like people will just start over again. You know, eventually. I mean,
yeah,
I don't know.
That could happen that way. That's not the way it is happening at the moment in a lot of the world. In that, you know, we've used carbon credits to cover up carbon for some producers while they were in the process of doing the work necessary to reduce carbon emission. That's what's happening in the rich part of the world. And you know, and every time a solar panel goes up, every time a hybrid car is used, every time a wind turbine goes up, that also helps to reduce, keep you from going back to the bad part. However, you are right, if we are also looking at the global picture, and we're looking at countries like India and China, where that transformation is not occurring just yet, where the renewable forms of energy are replacing the non-renewable forms. So it's a race. But you know, it's a race, but in a way that where anything you can do to tip the balance is important. And we won't know. You're right. We could lose that race. But we'll lose it even faster, say, if we don't do it, we'll do some of the things I was talking about.
Thank you.
One more? Oh, here's some students over here. We'll let some teachers ask a question in a minute.
Okay, so that cocoa bean guy.
Yeah.
I was wondering, since you said he got his land from the government and the government owns his land, did they also own part of his business, or is that completely his?
No, it's completely his.
And follow-up question, do you think it would help if the government had a vested interest in helping people like that, like if they did get some of the profit from their business?
If the government got profit from their business?
Yeah, like do you think that would help them?
No, I don't think that would help because it would just be one cut. You know, I have to say, the whole question of land ownership in Brazil is really thorny. It's a big, big deal because back in when it was colonized, it was basically the entire vast country was handed off to 12 families. They set it up as a feudal system, as a colony, not what happened here. And so there's always been these super rich people. You wouldn't think so, but Brazil has the largest difference between rich and poor of all the countries in the world. You know, you think that's Eritrea or something, but it's not. It's actually Brazil. Because you have super, super rich and a tiny 1% up here. And then you have this vast area of people who have literally nothing. So the interim step is they don't get to own that land, but they get to control it as long as they meet certain rules. And then in that way, they are doing something very important for the government, and the government does have a vested interest because they're protecting the forest.
Can I ask a question which I think involves this young woman's question, which was, how do you give the governments an incentive to want to make the changes that need to happen to enforce the laws?
Well, that's a $64,000 question, right? Because in Brazil, you have a central government, a national government, that's very keen to enforce these laws. And then at state level, you have state governments who are very kind of iffy about enforcing these laws. And then you get down to local governments, and you have some that are absolutely involved in law breaking. And it's because those are the local, sometimes criminals, sometimes legitimate, but large owners of land who say, this belongs to us, we're going to do whatever we like with it, as well as that public land, we're just going to do whatever we like with it. And in Brazil, there's certainly an enormous tension, and in Pakistan it's the same, enormous tension between people who live on the land and people who own the land, and what's going to happen in terms of who gets to control what happens. So part of that is educational, right? Because if everyone comes to understand that everyone will be a lot better off ultimately if the land is kept renewable. But part of it's about enforcement. So, you know, we know that in Brazil, there's really a war going on. So you have federal police. They have one of the best anti-slavery operations in the world in Brazil. They have special anti-slavery squads. They have special judges who are mobile judges who can, like, drive down and make a judgment just like that. Fantastic. But then you also have local police who are operating like armed gangs, killing people who try to stop deforestation or try to stop slavery. So down on the grassroots, it's like it's the Wild West. You know, think of a cowboy movie, right? Randolph Scott, he's got a badge. But Ernest Borgnine, he's got a gun. Right?
I think we have time for one more question.
It sounds like it's not sneaking in the night, but changing whole systems. And so is it different in every country, or?
Getting people out of slavery, it's not necessarily different in every country, but it's different with every type of enslavement. Slightly different, right? So when I talked about kicking in the door and taking a kid, right, when kids are enslaved and making carpets in northern India and southern Pakistan, that's exactly how it is. They are locked into a single room with a loom, and they have to do this night and day, and you have to literally kick doors in and take them out one at a time. Right? And you have to tend to go in there when you know the slaveholders are available and run away because they'll cut, otherwise they get their guns out and they shoot. But a lot of places, and in this country, it's very much often about individuals, right? Finding a way to contact that individual through the through texting or on the phone or letting them text you or using a locator on their phone to find out where they're being held and all this. You know, you can do all that kind of stuff in the United States. And it tends to come out as individuals. But the places where there's the most slavery, it's very often in significant parts of the community are enslaved. And that's across South Asia, Southeast Asia, down into, and lots of parts of Africa, particularly North and West Africa. In those, we call it like the Obama model or the Fannie Lou Hamer model, right? Because it's about community organizing. And you have to have people of the same ethnicity, speaking the same language, same religious background, often ex-slaves themselves, that show up and say, I used to live like this, but there's another way. And then it turns into a conversation that comes into an organizing that turns into a movement, which is often dangerous. But in, and it really is really close to what happened in the Mississippi Delta in 1962, where people came into the community and said, there's another way this community can operate if we work together, and we're willing to take risks. And that happens too. Again, this is one of those things that we've learned a lot about in the last 10 to 15 years. But it's also something that about which we need to know a lot more. There's no book on how to get people out of slavery. There's some manuals, but there's no study about different types of slavery and different types of liberation to make that happen. Guys, thank you ever so much. I'm sorry I didn't get to answer every question.